Welcome to worship this morning. It is great to see all of you here in the sanctuary and all of you joining us online. Welcome to worship on this first Sunday of Advent. I invite you to take a moment to note the announcements on the insert in your bulletin, as well as the calendar on the back of your bulletin. A couple of highlights. The first gathering of those interested in the reforming handbell choir is this Thursday. You'll also see a note there about some new office hours for me, and if you have any questions about that, certainly let me know. And this Saturday is the memorial service for Reverend Ed, as we remember his life, his ministry, and his influence on our lives and in this community. There's one note about the service. Being a first Sunday, we are having communion, even though it's not listed. I just didn't put it in. So after the tithes and offerings, we will have communion this morning, and I'll guide you through that. But it'll be familiar, I think, to you. We come to the season of Advent, often wanting to rush to Christmas. The invitation is to pause in the midst of lives filled with many things, to make space for God, and to welcome in Emmanuel, the Christ child, Let us honor God with our worship today.
Would you please stand as you're comfortable and join me in the call to worship? One in hope, one in faith, and one in baptism.
We gather from the four winds to center our lives in Christ.
From the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven.
We gather to praise God, who is coming to us in clouds of power and glory.
The Master of the house invites us to embark on the amazing journey of Advent.
Along this journey, we pause to worship our God.
Our first hymn is Let All Mortal Flesh Keep Silence, found on the screen, and also number 626 in the red hymnals.
God, we come to this season of Advent, a time of much expectation and excitement, but also of waiting and watching. Send to us a renewed sense of hope, not for things that maybe, possibly, could have, if we think hard enough, will happen, but the assured confidence of the real presence of your Spirit in our lives and through the life of Jesus the Christ. Let Jesus be born anew in us today as we worship together and in the season ahead, for we pray in your name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
In the days of exile and uncertainty, the prophet Isaiah cried out, Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence. As when fire sets twigs ablaze and causes water to boil, come down to make your name known to your enemies and cause the nations to quake before you. For when you did awesome things that we did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you.
In the midst of our own encounters with uncertainty and upheaval and our longing for deliverance, Jesus calls to us, "Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come."
We wait as people surprised again and again by God, who shakes us out of our complacency and wakes us up to the work of the kingdom all around us. We light this candle as a sign of our shocking hope. May we stay awake to God's activity in the world as we wait in expectation that even now God is with us, working to restore us to the fullness of life with God and one another. Amen.
Lesson today comes from Jeremiah chapter 33, verses 14 through 16. Both readings today are about hope, and I will be reading both these from the Message, which you might notice, especially on the second one, the language is a little bit different. It has more of a modern flair to it. On this reading, Jeremiah is speaking to the people of Israel, who have been conquered and scattered and were living in Babylonian captivity. He's addressing that the people are waiting in a period of darkness and that there was hope as light is about to break in after long waiting and a branch will sprout. Watch for this. The time is coming, God's decree, when I will keep the promise I made to the families of Israel and Judah. When that time comes, I will make a fresh and true shoot sprout from the David tree. He will run this country honestly and fairly. He will set things right. That's when Judah will be secure and Jerusalem live in safety. The motto for the city will be, God has set things right for us.
And join our Christmas music in a happy gospel style. Singing harmony with feeling, it will surely bring a smile. Songs that tell the wondrous story of the birthday of a king. When we start the Christmas music, here's a song we love to sing.
Baby, yes, my Lord.
Mary had a baby, yes, Lord. Little fancy baby was the Son of God.
When you hear the Christmas music,
yourself there by the fire, and you'll hear the story told about the shepherds and the angels singing way up in the sky. How the shepherds left that evening and the Lord they glorified.
Up, shepherd, and follow.
It will lead to the place where the Christ was born.
Rise up, shepherd, and follow.
Follow, follow. Rise up, shepherd, and follow. Follow the star of Bethlehem.
Rise up, shepherd, and follow. Carols in a joyous spirit. You can hear them loud and clear.
You can sing them a cappella. It's a special time of year.
People celebrate the season, and each singer will agree. Every voice adds to the singing. Join our Christmas jubilee.
Go tell it on the mountain.
Children to come forward. And we're going to gather over here today. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good to see you. So today's a special day in the church. What is special about today?
We start Advent.
Start Advent. It's kind of a funny word. We don't use that very often.
No.
What do you think Advent's about? You can both have a turn. That's all right.
Go. Go.
I guess.
Christmas.
We're starting to get ready for Christmas, right? And so one of the ways we do that is we have this, a lot, or at least a lot of churches have something like this. What do we call this?
Advent candles.
Advent candles, the Advent wreath. And the first candle, we, as we heard a few minutes ago, is the candle of hope. Now, what are some things you hope for in this season?
I hope have a board
to come together and not fight.
Same.
Anything else you hope for around Christmas? What do you think about this season? What is something you look forward to? What is something you get excited about?
Christmas.
Christmas.
Anything about Christmas or just
getting presents and hanging out with family?
Presents and hanging out for with family, yeah.
Friends.
And friends. Those are really cool things, right? As Christians, we also hope for a really special present, and that is Jesus, right? So Jesus doesn't always come wrapped in a nice glittery box with a lovely bow under the tree, but is always here with us. So family and friends, even presents, are pretty cool, right?
Yeah.
But all of that is made possible by Jesus, the one who made us, and the one who always loves us. And so each week we'll light a candle, partly to help us take some time and to remember all that God has done for us as we get ready for Christmas. Let's have a prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you for meeting us in this season. We look forward to so much, whether it's yummy food, gatherings with friends and family, giving and receiving gifts, and so much more. But help us never, ever forget that all of this is even possible because of what you gave, your very Son, Jesus. So we thank you and pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for coming.
The second reading today will be from Luke chapter 21, verses 5 through 19. It's another reading in which it's grounded in hope. In the hope that God remains present in the world and for us, even if it can seem if it, everything is being lost. If you could please rise as you're able for the gospel lesson. One day, people were standing around talking about the temple, remarking how beautiful it was, the splendor of its stonework and memorial gifts. Jesus said, "All this you're admiring so much, the time is coming when every stone in that building will end up in a heap of rubble." They asked him, "Teacher, when is this going to happen? What clue will we get that is about to take place?" He said, "Watch out for the doomsday deliverers. Many leaders are going to show up with forged identities claiming, 'I'm the one,' or 'the end is near.' Don't fall for any of that. When you hear of wars and uprisings, keep your head and don't panic. This is routine history and no sign of the end." He went on, "Nation will fight nation, and ruler will fight ruler, over and over. Huge earthquakes will occur in various places. There will be famines. You'll think at times that the very sky is falling. But before any of this happens, they'll arrest you, hunt you down, and drag you to court and jail. It will go from bad to worse. Dog eat dog, everyone at your throat, because you carry my name. You'll end up on the witness stand, called to testify. Make up your mind right now not to worry about it. I'll give you the words and wisdom that will reduce all your accusers to stammerers and stutters. You'll even be turned in by parents, brothers, relatives, and friends. Some of you will be killed. There's no telling who will hate you because of me. Even so, every detail of your body and soul, even the hairs of your head, is in my care. Nothing of you will be lost. Staying with it, that's what is required. Stay with it to the end. You won't be sorry. You'll be saved." The word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Please be seated. So this morning begins a series that will begin here in Advent and continue up through Epiphany. These Sundays in Advent, we'll be thinking about some of the central themes of this season. And in many cases, they're words we see scattered throughout our hymns and the scriptures, and we often glance right by, at least I find I do, without really thinking about what do they really mean? What is the meaning about these? Because they're in many ways central to our faith. And then as we move into Christmas season, we'll continue that, but from the perspective of Christmas. So today, the theme is hope, which is the one also that just happens to coincide with the first candle, which many of you think of as the hope candle. So it's a nice representation as well. Though first, would you please pray with me? Gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts together. Be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Have any of you ever heard of the musical band Sixpence None the Richer? Oh, a few of you have. I had not heard of them, actually, until I was reading this week to get ready for the service today. So some of you, those of you who have heard of them may know this story. A couple decades ago, they had their record label went out of business, and so their contract fell to another company. But because of issues with their contract, they weren't able to record any new music. And of course, that's for many recording artists, that's the lifeblood of their work. That's how they make a significant amount of their money. At least that's how it was for them, for sure. They made ends meet only by doing these long, pretty exhausting tours. And it was really grueling. And at one point, one of the members left. And as they were coming around to the second year of this, they were all thinking about leaving. And they loved being together. They loved making music. But life was getting fairly untenable. They stuck with it a little longer, but were really wondering if the end was near. When finally they were released from their contract, they were able to go actually to another label and to begin recording again. And one of the members talked about how significant his faith was in that. And he said, the thing is, when things are going well, we tend to relax, take it a little easy, and think, life isn't so bad. But sometimes when we do that, we also don't give as much attention to our relationship with God. He wanted people to keep in mind that it was important to always keep that relationship strong so that when the tough times come, you have the ability to make it through whatever it is you're facing. That was how he defined hope. You can think of hope as the assured confidence a person has in what God will do. The assured confidence that we as a Christian would have in what God will do. And it's very different than how a lot of times we use the word hope in society today. We might say, gee, I hope I get that new job. But sometimes we don't. I hope I recover from a serious injury. Sometimes we don't. I hope I'll have enough money to pay for whatever this goal is. Sometimes we don't. I hope the Patriots will win today. Oh, wait. We already know. All right. Some things are a little beyond hope. But anyway, hope is often this, we wish it will, we're crossing our fingers that it might, we hope it all works out. That's not the kind of hope that the scriptures talk about. The scriptures talk about a certainty, something we can have complete confidence in. It's not a maybe, it's not a if it all works out. It's not a, if you do this and this and this and this, and someone else does these five things, and you hit just the right moment, then it will all come together. It is something you can have complete confidence in. When we talk about our hope, and you see it in a number of our carols this season, you'll see it in a number of prayers and resources. We're talking about that complete confidence that the Christian has in God fulfilling the promises made to us. These promises embodied in this season by the expectation of a baby in a manger. That from our standpoint today reminds us not only of what God has done, or even what God is doing, but also our expectation that Christ will come again, as we say every time we do communion. That Christ will be part of our life. Not that our hope erases any heartache. Not that our hope makes life always smooth and easy, or eliminates any bumps or heartaches along the way, but that our hope will see us through whatever comes our way in life. So hope is that assured confidence. Hope is also active. And that might have been, God may be ready. Sometimes we're not. It takes a regular dedication to our life of faith, to our study of the scriptures, to our worship together, to the fellowship of the larger Christian community, both within and beyond these walls. We make hope real by actively working to make it a reality in our world. We don't slip into the, well, I hope Jesus will make a difference in my life. We make that hope real. It might be the hope that is represented by the Christmas angels that so many of you have given. It wasn't just, I hope that the people in our community who could really use a shining light in their season, I hope it'll all work out. You made that hope tangible and real in your giving. For all of you who contributed to the event on Friday night for the clothing exchange, you were thinking not just about, well, I hope the people who could really use clothing in this community who may not have the means or the sources to afford some of what they need, you turn that hope into reality. Whether you gave clothes or you gave time for that event or you made cookies or whatever you did, you worked to make that hope real. So my question for us this morning is, what is it about this season in the many things that many of you will have planned that is about making hope real? What is it that you will do that will make hope tangible and felt by the people who could really use it, which is in some ways probably all of us? So hope is that assured confidence. Hope is active. And hope is embodied. For us, we see that as Christians, specifically in the person of Jesus. It is not about pie in the sky thinking that's unrealistic or beyond our reach, really, but embodied in one of the most vulnerable moments in a person's life, maybe the most vulnerable, is when we're born. The Christ child, completely dependent on his parents, and yet representing in the flesh Emmanuel, the hope of the world, through which we could have that confidence, through which his life and teaching would excite people about the possibility of hope made real, through whom the cross that we will be pointing to in only a few months represented God's triumph over the worst that people could throw at another person. That assured confidence that God would be and is always with us, would be and is always offering grace, would be and is giving us what we need to work our way through life, to be signs of hope for one another, and to show the world that God is active in it and is interested in it, that we would become the creations God made us to be. Our scriptures today, at first glance, might have made you think that, or made you wonder at least, why are these passages here? These sound really dark and bleak and not very joyful or happy. The passage from Jeremiah, which came from the exile, and a time that the Israelites, because they had repeatedly not followed what God had wanted and repeatedly had turned on them, it led to their exile. You could say in some ways their disobedience led to their being cut off from God, except they were the ones that really had done the cutting off. Even then, with the people in exile, there were the shoots of hope, the realization that God wasn't done with them yet, that though they didn't know when and it doesn't always come on our timetable, that God still had something to say and something to do with his people. And eventually they did come back from exile, and life in a new way, but nonetheless was restored, or the relationship was restored. Even when we find ourselves in those dark valleys, sometimes like the psalmist says, the valley of the shadow of death, God seeks us out to restore and reconcile. We can have hope that even in our darkest moments, God has not forgotten us. And we see in the gospel too, the imagery of the destruction of the temple, and again, seems really dark and bleak. It was really a very unhappy time in what we now today think of as Israel. But again, if the people could not lose sight of their relationship with God, they could see that hope was not lost. It was not the hope that is fleeting in the moment, or the hope that is wishful, but a confident hope that the future was not lost. How do you have hope? That is to say, assured confidence in your future, in our future, as Christians, as citizens of the world. It's really easy, isn't it, to see headlines or talk with your friends at the coffee shop or your neighbors when you get together and see so much that is not well and not right. And there's some real legitimate concerns. But if they overwhelm us, if we lose sight of what God is doing, we are likely to cut off in our fear or worry, our sense of hope that God has shown throughout the many centuries and continues to show today that we can have confidence in. We don't just cross our fingers and hope for the best. We have confidence in our hope, with a capital H, that God embodied in Jesus is not only the Savior of our lives, but the one through whom the rest of the world too can have its hope. For a future that we can confidently say, when connected to God, will be grace-filled, joy-filled, and productive according to the gifts we've been given. Not always easy, not always without heartache, but something we can always get through because of where we place our hope. Would you please pray with me? Holy God, give us the hope, or restore in us hope. The hope that was proclaimed when you made the world and pronounced it good. The hope that was proclaimed again and again by your prophets. The hope that was proclaimed by your Son Jesus. The one not based in armies or politics or economic might, but the hope that comes through relationships and common concern one with another. The hope that was proclaimed by disciples and apostles, teachers and leaders and pastors throughout the ages. Not centered on an institution or anyone of the church, but centered on you. Help us, we pray, never to lose sight of you as the source of our hope. That confident assurance that you have done and will always be ready to do all that you have promised. Help us with eyes and spirits open, see and experience how you fulfill those promises, that we might with our lives proclaim a hope to the world. And so we pray in your name. Amen. As we come to our time of prayer, we'll do the Lord's Prayer during communion, so we won't do that here, but we will take a few moments for your prayer requests, joys, concerns, maybe special introductions you would like to make this morning. If you have a prayer request, just raise your hand so we can get a microphone to you to make sure, at the very least, people online can hear us.
Prayers for safe travels for Kate and John Wilder this week.
Our prayers for safe travels for Kate and John Wilder this week. Any others? If not, then let us enter into a spirit of prayer once more. Gracious God, you have heard our prayers. Some we've spoken out loud. Some we've spoken in our very souls. We thank you for meeting us where we are in hearing them. And we pray you can use us to be an answer to prayer through our friendships and relationships, through our connections and working with and among the community, through our ministries of teaching, of worship, of music, as we celebrate your ongoing work and presence with us. We think too of our sisters and brothers around this world, some of whom, just to look at their situation, we would think, what is it that they have to hope for? Till we remember the answer, which is what keeps them going, is the confidence they have in you. You are theirs and our hope. Help us to not waver in that confidence, come what may. All this we thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. As God so richly blesses us, we now receive our morning tithes and offerings. For the gifts of time, talent, and treasure we can turn into grace encountered and experienced and lived, we thank you. For these gifts of bread and cup that not only remind us of your greatness, but also enable us to participate in it today, we thank you. For the gifts of faith through which we have our hope, we thank you. For all this and so much more, we thank you with all that we are and all we have. In the name of Jesus the Christ, amen. You may be seated. If you would turn in your hymnals, please, to page 13. Page 13. And I invite you to join with me responsively in the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing. Always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be a light to the nations. You scatter the proud in the imagination of their hearts, and have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones, and exalt those of low degree. You fill the hungry with good things, and the rich you send empty away. Your own Son came among us as a servant to be Emmanuel, your presence with us. He humbled himself in obedience to your will and freely accepted death on a cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, and having passed it around that table with his disciples, said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink from this cup, do so in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Our Father, which art
Emmanuel comes to meet us in the broken places of life. But as we break this bread, we are reminded too that in that meeting, we receive what we need to sustain us. We receive our hope that will get us through whatever we encounter. This cup represents too all that God gave, that we would have the joy of life and the hope that we have. And no matter who we are, God offers the same gift, given to us without price, for God's continued work in this world. In the United Methodist tradition, we observe an open table. That means you do not need to be a United Methodist or a member of this congregation or a member of any church in particular, because we believe that in receiving communion, you can encounter the very grace of God. We will have stations at the front of the aisle. If you would come down the center at the direction of the ushers, returning by the side aisle, feel free to stay at the rail if you wish for prayer or reflection for as long as you need. Come now, for the table is ready. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is hymn 196 in your hymnal or on the screen, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. As we get ready to go about the rest of our day and week, I pray, I bid that we go not hoping that everything will work out, but with confidence that the hope that we have in Christ will see us through, and much more than that, will help us grow in the knowledge and experience of the grace and the joy of God. So we go with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, with the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, now and always. Amen.
Amen.
May the Lord God guide us in love and grant us peace through all our trials. May he shelter us from harm and keep us safe and warm. As we go along, may the love of Jesus go with you. As we part and go our separate ways, may we be more like him with a love that shines within. Father, hear our prayer. Amen. Join our Christmas music in a happy gospel style. Singing harmony with feeling, it will surely bring a smile. Songs that tell the wondrous story of the birthday of a king. When we start the Christmas music, here's a song we love to sing.
Mary had a baby, yes, my Lord.
Mary had a baby, yes, Lord. The little bitty baby was the Son of God.
When you hear the Christmas music, singing songs both new and old,
warm yourself there by the fire, and you'll hear the story told of the shepherds and the angels singing way up in the sky. How the shepherds left that evening, and the Lord they